of what to do. They were not praying blindly. That's how, even when it, that's when it comes to marriage, you see young people doing that. I don't want a man of my dreams, the man of God's dream. Now, and what's the man of God's dream? He's praying, she's praying, he's praying blindly. Think God just show you one stranger and say, that's your husband. No. You said there are things that are already settled in the scriptures that doesn't require prayer first. A believer does not marry an unbeliever. Amen. That's simple. So there's no way you want to pray. Your prayer or your search with prayer will be limited within that, you know, that circle of what? Of believers. Are you with me? Will be limited within the circle of believers. So you see this ones, they did not do what we used to do back then on campus at RCM. We do Alapala, and Alapala at some point Alapala would just go and pick one innocent person. One young person who just got on campus, who should be allowed to learn and grow. Amen. On dread level, they just pick you, you are already mama. You don't even know what to do. And the funniest thing is, those ones will cry. Within 1-2 days, they will cry. After 4 days, they become boss. They are already strengthened. They are already giving orders. When there is a pastor in church teaching, they sit like co-pastors. They can't learn again. They only learn when it is now, if they are sitting under very obviously bigger men of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. They are not just learning because it's the word again. They are learning because of the personality involved. All of a sudden, you are a papa. All of a sudden, you are a minister. You are not a minister because Goya oil is poured upon you. You are a minister because you have been trained. Praise the Lord. Amen. There was nobody Jesus called that he poured oil on. Am I saying it is wrong to pour oil on people? No, it's not wrong. At best, it's symbolic. You are only showing that you have appointed them. Amen. You're only showing. But what proves anybody's appointment into the work of God is training. Amen. Yeah. Training. So if a believer has not been trained, such believer is not qualified to lead. You can't lead without being trained. Your responsibility cannot be committed into your hands without being trained. And this training will happen in the assembly of God's people. Amen. You are trained. It's not a special kind of training where they say you have 4 weeks Bible course. No, that's not the training. The training is you are part of a local church. You have served in a local church. You sit under a pastor. You know what discipleship is. Amen. You've been discipled. You've been given instructions many times. If you know that you've not learned to take instructions, you cannot give instructions. Amen. You cannot follow the Spirit of God if you have not learned to follow men. Praise the Lord. You cannot follow the leading of the Spirit if you have not learned to follow the simple instructions in church. Come early to church. Let us fast. Let us give. Let us do this. When you begin to learn how to follow those simple instructions, you are already grooming yourself to follow the leading of the Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So he said, let us of some of the men who were with us all the time. Amen. We are going to pick from those men. But did they later pray? Yes, they prayed. But did they pray blindly? And did they do a blank prayer? No, they didn't do a blank prayer. They prayed after they resolved in their heart that it is only those who have been with our Lord Jesus Christ from the beginning who have been going in and out with us. Going in and out means that they learnt at the feet of Jesus. Amen. They ministered with Jesus. They were part of the people that Jesus sent out on evangelism. So they did evangelism. They learned evangelism. They learned everything from Christ. All that Christ went through in the course of his earthly ministry, they were part of it. So they said, one of those men will be qualified to take the place of Judas. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. So where are we? So let's read from 21 and read everything together now so it will make lots of sense. Therefore, of this man who have accompanied us, we're reading from verse 21. Therefore, of this man who have accompanied us all the time, that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. Verse 23, and they proposed to Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias, and they prayed and said. See when they prayed. After they had peed, so it would mean that those two guys were both were qualified. I said the God doesn't use the qualified, the God qualifies the one that he calls. It's a life from the pit of hell. Praise the Lord. If he calls you first, he will still ensure that you are what? You are qualified. So God doesn't call. You can't be a farmer today and God just called you and tomorrow you are already carrying bed. Who trained you? What do you even know that you are going to say? Amen.
Amen.
This is how error comes into the body. What do you know that you are going to say? A lot of time people would cite some exceptional cases. They want to go to Paul, as though Paul did not learn. Paul was already a Pharisee. He already knew the scriptures. What was missing in his knowledge was that all the things that you have learned point to Christ. That was what was missing. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That was what was missing in the knowledge of Paul. In the theology of Paul, that was what was missing. Christ, Christology was what was missing in the theology of God. So, because there's no way you can study God without Christ. Christ is the study of God. Jesus is the explanation of God. But the understanding of scriptures that Paul had before he had that encounter did not accommodate Jesus. So when he had the encounter, Jesus said, I am the one that you persecute. You're persecuting. He sent Ananias to him. Ananias got him filled in the Holy Ghost. He had time. He separated himself unto Arabia to go and check things again. So when Moses was saying this, it was Christ Jesus. So when this was, they said it was Jesus. And then he was still part of the church. Don't forget that it was from the gathering of the church that he received the mandate to what? To go forward. Separate Barnabas and Saul. The scripture says the prophet, the apostles, they gathered and they were praying, they were fasting unto the Lord. And it was in that gathering, it was in that meeting that the Holy Ghost said, separate Paul and Barnabas for the work that I'm going to do with them. So God doesn't call people that has not been trained. He's going to train. You might not have human qualifications. You might be the one, you might not be educated. It is not English that you want to use to do the work. It is not car that you want to use to do the work. So you can, in every sense of it, the person doesn't look at human qualifications. But there are spiritual qualifications. And that's why you see even in the letter that Paul wrote to Timothy, he said a bishop should not be a babe. Praise the Lord. He said anyone who desires the office of a bishop, he said he desired a good thing. He now wrote out what the person must do. Praise the Lord. So you cannot be called to do the work of God except you're trained. And that training happens in the local church. That training happens in the assembly of God's people. So every child of God must submit to the authority of the church. Every child of God must submit to the authority of the church. If you're struggling to submit to the authority of the church, that's you struggling to submit to the authority of God. The church is the agency of God. So they had two people to pick from, and then they prayed. Amen.
Amen.
And they what? They prayed. Verse 24. And they prayed and said, you, O Lord, who know the heart of all, show which of these two you have chosen to take part in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. Matthias. Okay, and they cast their lot, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Hallelujah. So you see that this happened where? In the church, in their garden. Amen.
Amen.
So Matthias was picked amongst the 12. So you see how leadership of the church, how they chose a leader in the church. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So you don't join a church today and tomorrow, because you are giving them money, they say you are minister of finance. The way some appointment happen in church, it's easy to know why certain things happen. There's one woman, one older woman that has money and he has provision store. She's the minister in charge of children, so that she can be bringing her own bobo from her shop and be giving them. What new wisdom? What new strategy? Amen.
Yeah.
There are people who are ministers because they are going to build the church. Those are the people you are discussing scriptures. They are bringing. Have you been to churches where people are not trained before they make them ministers? People will be saying different things. You are fighting. Pastor cannot caution you. That's because they've not been trained. A believer that has been trained would know it's a shameful thing to fight. A believer that has been trained would know that it is ungodly to fight. Amen. Amen. Not even saying you are not even fighting pastor. You've not seen churches where pastor's wife and other women in church, they are fighting. Praise the Lord. Carnality. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go ahead. Let's go. Let's go forward. Acts of Apostles chapter 2. Are we getting blessed this morning?
Yes, sir.
Acts of Apostles chapter 2. We're going to read from verse 1 to 4. Now when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were what?
With one accord.
Where?
In one place.
So they are not in one accord scattered everywhere. They are with one accord in one place. You can't run away from gathering. The blessing of God is in the gathering of his people. The blessing of God is in the assembly of his people. He said, on the day of Pentecost. And now, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Verse 2 says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. How many people were filled with the Holy Ghost?
All.
So you attend a place that some preacher is saying, one person, God want to bless one person here, and everybody is seeing it as a competition. It's not competition in God's house. It's a commonwealth. You know what it means to be commonwealth? Praise the Lord. The church life, the church system of government is a communal system. Praise the Lord. We are all partakers of God's blessings. God does it. God is not doing a yijo or a yoje. It's not permutation. It's not Baba Jebu. It's not lottery. It's not visa lottery. It's not amen. One person with the loudest amen. I don't know where people got that from. The person with the loudest amen is going to get this blessing. No. The blessing of God is for his people. The blessing of God is for his assembly. Teach men to know him in the church of God. In the church of God, we teach men. In the church of God, men receive teaching. Amen. You see the two sides to it. In the church of God, what's the duty of the pastor? To teach men. In the church of God, what's the duty of men? To receive the teaching. Amen. So to receive the teaching, you must always come to church. You must be part of the church. You must gather with the assembly. Amen.
Amen.
Don't forsake the assembly. Amen.
Amen.
So they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost did not go after them one after the other. The Holy Ghost came upon them in the assembly. Hallelujah. Acts of Apostles chapter 2 from verse 40. Let's look at verse 40. Are we there?
Yes, sir.
Verse 40 to 47. Acts of Apostles. Chapter 2, verse 40. Okay. Amen.
Amen.
So this was after that Peter preached. Amen. After that Peter preached to the multitude who thought the church were drunk. You know that we read from Acts of Apostles chapter 1. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
We read from Acts of Apostles chapter 1 where Jesus told them to tarry, to wait for the promise. We've seen Acts of Apostles chapter 2 where they waited for the promise. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, the Holy Ghost descended upon them all, and they were all filled with Holy Ghost. And after they were filled with Holy Ghost, they began to speak in tongues. Amen. As they began to speak in tongues, men of different nations and different tribes heard them speak their different languages. Now, speaking in tongues is not speaking in foreign earthly language. It's an unknown language. But then there's interpretation of tongues. So they spoke in tongues and they interpreted tongues. They had interpretations in the different dialect and in different languages of those who were present. Amen. They had what? The interpretation in the different dialect and the different languages of those who were present. So they saw them speaking in tongues. They saw them doing all of that and they said, wow, these guys are drunk. And Peter stood up and said, you know, men of Judea, men of Jerusalem, You know, these ones are not joking as you suppose. Amen. But this is the fulfillment of the promise of God as prophesied by the prophet Joel. Joel 2:28. Afterwards, I'll pour down my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams and your young men will see vision. So Peter stood up and explained. And after the preaching of Peter, Peter preached and preached and preached. After his preaching, this was what happened. Amen. Praise the Lord. This was what happened after the preaching of Peter. Let's read from verse 28. Then Peter said to them, from verse 38, are we there? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many the Lord our God will call. Verse 40, and with many other words he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Verse 41, then those who gladly received his words were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they what? They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Amen. Praise the Lord. Are you seeing that? Hallelujah. They continued steadfastly. You know, thousands were added to the church. And they didn't say, now that thousands have been added, we don't think we'll be able to gather again. You know, everybody should just go and be doing your thing differently. No. After that, thousands were added onto the church, they still continued. That's why the church is not doing a thing to see result and stop. No, it's a culture. Hallelujah. It's a culture. So if we are giving, we are not giving to attract people. Amen. You know, you see different churches open for business. You see different strategies. Some, when they started, they were giving things. Some, they say it is free meal tickets. We're going to have access to lunch after church. All kinds of gimmicks to bring people to church. Now, is it wrong to give people food in church? No. But if the motive is solely to attract them to come to church, then that's where the problem is. What should bring people to church is God's word. Amen. If God's word cannot bring them, then God's word will not keep them. Amen. If God's word can't bring them, God's word will not keep them. If you bring them with food, you will need to keep giving them food to let them remain. Amen. If you bring them, if it is a church where the pastor pays church member salary, amen. You know, you've not heard of place where they are paying church members salary. Oh, I've heard one where they pay church members salary. And a new pastor was posted to a place and he went to the pastor and said, Alpha. I said, Alpha, what's Alpha? Pastor always gives us salary. Salary for what? What are you doing that pastor is giving? Pastor is giving you money for coming? Amen. Praise the Lord. We can help ourselves. We can encourage ourselves. Hallelujah. Even with money. But that's not why we gather. Amen. So we don't go say, our church, come to our church. We have very good facility. If you use good facility to bring people to church, you need to keep having good facility. When another church opens close to you and there is a better facility, you are already telling people that the facility or the building is the real deal. They can move to the next place. Praise the Lord. That's not why we gather. Hallelujah. So you see that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Amen. And what? In fellowship. And what? In breaking of what? Of bread. And what? In prayer. Do you know that sometimes why you cannot pray well is because you are not praying with church. Church is where you learn prayer. See, your personal prayer life would stem from your church. Amen. The strength of your prayer life will be from your church. When you learn to gather with church is praying 1 hour. You join them to pray 1 hour. You know, if you are praying alone, when you make up your mind you want to pray 1 hour, if you get tired at 2 minutes or you get distracted at 2 minutes, but because it's just only you, nobody's watching you, you just stand up, you go. But in church, even if you don't want to pray, you see them leading prayer, pastor is praying. Amen. You will not want to sit down, you will pray. And before you know what's happening, you will join them in praying one another. So there is strength in togetherness. There is what? Strength in togetherness. Do not despise the gathering of the church. The gathering of saints helps you, even with spiritual things, helps you to grow spiritually, helps you how do I put it? To learn the culture of the faith. Amen. You know, you learn to study, you sit under teachings for hours. When you get home, you can sit with your own Bible too for hours. Amen. So it will flow from the church. If you are sleeping under 30-minute sermon in church, that shows you cannot read your own Bible at home for 5 minutes. Amen. So you see example here. After that, people saw, you know, what did these people hear before they were added to the church? They heard sermon. So after they were added to the church, what happened again?
They continued with the sermon.
So they continued with the apostles' doctrine. The apostles' doctrine is teaching. The apostles' teaching. And the apostles' teaching is the teaching of Christ. Hallelujah. So they continued with that, and they continued with what? Fellowship. That is, they continued to have that koinonia. They continued to have that fellowship together. Amen.
Amen.
They continue to have the fellowship together, and they continue to break bread together. So even food, the things they do in the natural, they do together. So believers have common identity. Amen.
Amen.
And they continue in prayer. Amen. Amen. Still read on from verse 44. Amen. Amen. Are we there?
Yes.
From verse 44.
No.
And all that
were
together had all things
common. All that what? Were what?
Were together.
And did what? Had all things in common. So you're seeing that we've been reading from Acts of Apostles chapter 1. No, nothing individualistic about the church. Nothing as though God is dealing with one person. No. He said they were what? They were all together. Amen. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. Verse 45. And sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continue, verse 46. With one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. The Lord added to what? The church daily. See the things they did together. They had all things in common. Said those who believe were what? Always together. They had everything in common. Amen?
Amen.
These people were always together every day. That's why today, you know, the modern day church has lots of challenges. One of the major challenges is that we are so occupied with activities in the world that the time that we spend to meet are so limited. How many hours did we say in the week last week? 168. And out of 68, out of 168 hours, we meet 2 hours on Sunday. We meet, well, 1.5 hour on Friday. That's 3.5 hour out of 168. Amen.
Yeah.
So if we are going to experience the same growth or the same edification as the church in Acts of Apostles, it will mean that we would need to find time and create that time where we commune regularly together. So even that 2 hours 1 week apart, don't miss it. Mm-hmm. Amen. Don't miss it. Don't miss out. Praise the Lord. Your diet, your food is in the church. Your spiritual food is in the church. It's like not eating for 2 weeks. Not listening to God's word for your whole day. That's like you've not eaten for your whole day. That's why we must create a culture as a church to see how that God's word is retained in our heart at all times. To see how that we can be part. That's why you as a member, don't frustrate the plan of the church. The plan of the church to ensure that we grow, don't frustrate it. How not to frustrate it is follow simple instructions. Amen. Be part of church meetings. Amen. Be part of the programs of the church. When the church say, oh, we are evangelizing this week, do your part, evangelize. When the church say, oh, we are praying for the sick, you pray for the sick. When the church say, oh, we are giving, you give. Hallelujah. That's how to be a blessing in your church. So we've seen examples. He said, those who had gave. And they had everything what? In common. The ones who have money were not doing or be to the ones who don't have. They were not giving the ones with money, we're putting them on night table, putting the ones who don't have money at the back. A church is not even a place to have high table. Amen. Praise the Lord. So these are men, you know, there are different clubs in some places. So these are Melonia's club. This one, their own is they give church $1 billion every year. Praise the Lord. So when we're going for evangelism, they don't go. Amen. When you want to clean the church, they don't clean the church. The answer is to give money. No, that's not how it's designed. Everything must be done in common. You must have that common goal, that common, that communal living must be there. Amen. Amen.
Are we getting blessed?
Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Act of Apostles chapter 4. Act of Apostles chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. So this was after that they forbade them not to preach in the name of Jesus. They were flogged not to preach in the name of Jesus. Now see what happened. Verse 23. And being let go, they went to their own companions. They what?
Company
is all the same. They went to their own what? Companions. They went to their own company. That's to their where, to their gathering, to the church. They just flogged them. They did not go home. And they now call you, go anywhere. If you see the flogging that I received today, I don't even know when next I'll be coming to church. Pastor, that last week that I got home this, my uncle fought me. And I don't want to offend him. So I don't think I'll be coming to church in the next 3 weeks. These ones were flogged. Not flogging with pancreas. You know what it means to be flogged with the Jews? That they are whip, that thing they used in flogging Jesus. Amen. You know, Paul said he received I think 39 of that. Amen. They were flogged. And what did they do? They went back to their company. Let's see what they did in their company. Verse 23, let's read together. And being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God. With what? With what?
One accord.
And they said, Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people not vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Porteous, violent with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Now, Lord, look on their threat, and grant to your servant that with all boldness they may speak your word, by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Hallelujah. Are you seeing this? Are you seeing the benefit of gathering together? The benefit of being part of a local assembly. They were flogged not to preach in the name of Jesus again. They went back to their company. And scripture says the word, they raised their voice in one accord unto God. And when the Holy Ghost filled that place,
When said that place was what that ground was shaken, and they were all what? They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Not one person, not one person shall be blessed here today. No. They were what? All filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
They were all filled with the Spirit of God. Verse 32 to 37. Amen.
Amen.
Want to go? Let's read. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and what?
One soul. Amen. The multitude of what? Those who believed were of what? Of one heart and one soul.
Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And great grace was upon them all. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked. For all who were possessors of land or houses sold them, and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold, and laid them at the apostles' feet. And they distributed to each as anyone had need. And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles, which is translated son of encouragement, a Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Are you seeing this?
Yes.
Have all things in common. That's the culture of the church. You cannot be part of the church and behave badly in your secular life, in your natural life. When you're part of the church, you've learned the culture. That's why church is not just a place where we hear new things. Church is a place where, as you hear, you implement what you hear by the way we interact amidst ourselves. So we don't rush in and rush out of the church. Amen.
Amen.
We don't rush in and rush out of the church. So there is a culture of the church. There's a culture of the church, the assembly of God's people, and every believer must be part of it. Every believer must be part of it. Hallelujah. When we get home, we read Acts of Apostles. Write down Acts of Apostles chapter 5. Acts of Apostles chapter 5, verse 12 to 16. Acts of Apostles chapter 6, verse 1 to 7. Acts of Apostles chapter 8, from verse 1 to 8. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's rise on our feet. Amen. Let's rise on our feet. Okay, let me make this announcement first. All right, let's rise on our feet. Let's pray. Just go ahead and pray in tongues. Pray in tongues as you have God's word this morning. Let's pray in tongues.